Hey everybody, welcome to Artists Decoded. This is your host Yoshino, and this episode is sponsored by No Wave. The No Wave Art Collective is now offering limited edition artist proof t-shirts. There are four shirts available now till December 3rd. Keep in mind that there are only 100 prints available of each shirt, so make sure to get yours before it runs out. Go to nowave.bigcartel.com to purchase these limited edition t-shirts. Type in Artist Decoded, one word, with all caps at checkout to receive your 10% off. This is episode number 87 with artist and illustrator Steve Kim. Steve's a good friend of mine. He's also part of our art collective, No Wave. And I'm equally confused and fascinated by this conversation. I listened back to this episode and I felt like Steve and I were talking about pretty abstract concepts and theories in hindsight. But nevertheless, I really love Steve Kim's work and he's an incredible artist who I have a ton of respect for. If you want to go check out his work, go to Instagram at stvkmco or just search for Steve Kim. If you want to support Artist Decoded, there's a donate button on our website, artistdecoded.com. If you click that button, it'll take you directly to our PayPal. Any little bit helps, or you can leave a review for us on our iTunes page. So here it is, without further ado, my conversation with artist and illustrator, Steve Kim. Yeah, thanks for coming. And tell me what's new. How was, I know you were in Detroit doing the Red Bull House of Art.
Yeah, right. So over the summer, I got a, what was it? I think it was like a Facebook message maybe, or a phone call, I don't know, from Matt Neaton. He's the director of the Red Bull House of Art. And he was like, do you want to come over and like do this thing? And I was like, okay, sure. And that's basically it. Like, as far as I understand, it's like you can't apply for it. They just invite whoever they have in mind. Usually grouped by like process or mindset or something. So I was there with Felicia Forte. She's a painter, and Jose Mertz. So it was like a kind of like a spectrum between really like, I guess, like representation, abstraction, figure, and more illustrative, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think Jose is definitely, I would say, more towards the illustrative side. Yeah. And street art and murals and stuff like that. And Felicia is more of a painter's painter.
Yeah,
I don't know if she would be okay with that, but you know what I mean, right?
I know what you mean.
And yeah. I think, and so I'm kind of somewhere in between where I like to paint and like to draw. So
how does it work? Do you, you know, for that particular showcase, do you all collaborate on pieces, or is it kind of like you're just doing your own thing? And how does that work?
I mean, it's pretty open-ended. The final thing is basically they have a large gallery space in the basement. And I, you know, depending on the people there, like, I think right now there's Lucien Shapiro and like more like sculpture based things.
Lucien Shapiro?
Yeah, he's going to be. Yeah, he's going to be. Yeah.
So I just, mean, I don't know him personally, but.
Right. Yeah. So just depending on the group, like early on, Jose and I were talking about like maybe because I haven't done any mural based work, I was like, maybe I can help them out or collaborate or something. But as it gets towards the end, you just sort of kind of like, I don't know, enter something else, some other like mindset.
But didn't you end up doing some pretty large scale pieces for that show?
Yeah. So it was 3 months, about including the screen print, 30 pieces. And 6 of those were 4x6 foot, 5x6 foot. 60x72, 5x6 foot, mm-hmm. Oil paintings.
Okay.
Yeah. So that was fun. It was the first time I had done really large. That's the first time I've done really like oil painting in a long time. I'd done a few smaller pieces the year before, mm-hmm. or earlier in the year, but like that kind of large scale oil on canvas, that whole kind of setup, I hadn't done since after grad school, so about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, that's all I did for grad school. It's just oil on canvas. Uh-huh. Yeah, pretty big too.
So how is that process different from the way you usually work? Because you usually work on like smaller pieces, right? And usually works on paper.
Yeah. So like after grad school, and those two things, is one, just like running out of space and wanting to get into the illustration side of things, and wanting to, I wanted to get into, I felt like drawing just for whatever reason. I was like, I should draw something. And so I started working on portraits and worked with colored pencil. And I started realizing that these drawings that I was doing was really conducive to illustration work. In other words, you draw it out, scan it, and then finish it in Photoshop with colors and stuff like that. I hadn't done any of that before. I never did any. I went to Art Center for illustration, but I never did like really like digital illustration stuff. I was focused more on painting.
Wait, so are you saying you did the digital illustration stuff for the Red Bull House of Art
show? No, this is before. This was like
after grad school.
And
oh, okay.
So the drawing, that's why like you'll see kind of like a lot of like pieces that kind of relate to each other. Sometimes you see like a paint wash, like watercolor wash, or a drawing, or and then like a very, you know, like a digital piece. They all kind of come from the same place, mm-hmm. which is like the physical drawing, sometimes a watercolor wash, and then I incorporate those, the drawing and painting, and Photoshop to make the digital piece. Mm-hmm. Just depends.
Yeah.
And that's been small scale. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So let's take it back a little bit, because you were born in Korea, right? And mm-hmm. you came here at the age of two.
Yep.
What
so I'm technically like first generation, which kind of blows my mind.
What do you mean? Why does it blow your mind?
Because I'm the same generation as my sister, my brother. They came like later when they're like 14 and 18 respectively, and my mom. And so they're all more like way more like Korean, right? They're not like
white. Is it hard to communicate with them?
My Korean's awful, but it sort of gets the job done. But more, I would say, more than the language is the cultural kind of barrier.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
so right. I mean, whenever I visit family, it's like, it's just like, you know, it's all about just like, you know, what are the kids up to? How's the dog? My nieces and nephews. There's really nothing else to talk about. Like, I can't.
It's kind of superficial things.
Well, not superficial so much as like, I realize like my day to day like thinking and thoughts and like kind of like whatever I'm interested in, it's just like there's no really conveying that. I've tried. Uh-huh. You know, and it's not that they're not supportive, but it's just like, you know, they're, you know, the, you know, the daily grind, family, school, it's just a whole different like attitude, whereas I'm like trying to get away from existence. Yeah. Or whatever, you know. So
uh-huh. So you feel like, you know, with your immediate family and you, like, you're on kind of two different, I want to say planes of existence.
No, yeah, no, yeah.
Completely
no.
Different mindsets.
Yeah, yeah.
In ways, yeah.
For sure.
So then, okay, so that's interesting because, I mean, I kind of feel the same with my family, but I feel like my mom gets it a little bit more, but, like, other people in my immediate family, they don't really understand, like, that art side. Mm-hmm. So what made you want to get into the arts, you know?
Well, I just like, you know, like a lot of kids just like drawing as a kid. And I've always had that kind of like, you know, I've been thinking about it lately. And just like when you see something like on TV, television or whatever, it doesn't really matter what it is. And this feeling like I should be doing that, or I could do that, or I could do that better. Or, you know, just kind of like crunching the numbers, like how would I go about doing this thing? So
what do you mean by crunching the numbers? Like finding yourself
like how, yeah, like how you would do something differently. And it doesn't really matter if it's art related or not. You just kind of automatically kind of like have like ideas or an opinion or whatever. I guess it's basically an opinion, but with the assumption that you would do something about it versus just saying, yeah, I'm, you know, I love Yeezy or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Right. So I just a lot of drawing, painting, and I was a really terrible student, and I saw a catalog for Art Center. I was like, wow, this is before the internet, really? I mean, there was sort of an internet, but just a different time. And so, like, things like magazines especially, catalogs, school catalogs with art printed on them, they had this sort of, like, magical quality, you know?
Yeah.
And had this super weird binding because they, you know, the graphic design department works on it. So I just thought it was like the coolest thing. And I decided, well, I'll go to Art Center.
Because you got a full ride to Art Center, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's not...
Is that kind of weird for you to talk about?
No, because it's like I got it, but then I lost it. So it's like half, it's like I got it and then like half a ride, right?
Yeah.
But I mean...
Why did you lose it?
My GPA... Oh, my GPA dropped. I mean, I've been like a really... really good at not achieving things very well, you know?
No, I don't know. What does that mean?
So in other words, like before Art Center, you have to realize... I was just a really bad student, so just always got like bad grades at after third grade because I was just like, I realized that like, I became like disillusioned. Like I was a really good student, like when I had the goal of being a really good student, and then I had this kind of like third grade existential crisis, like what's the meaning of this and what's the point? And there's really no point. So I just floundered. And especially
you mean, what's the meaning of
school?
Oh yeah.
And grades.
Traditional
and
education.
Yeah. And all that stuff. Social life, friends, just like very unhappy in basically.
But what made you come to that conclusion as a third grader? And why specifically in third grade did you come to that conclusion?
I don't know. I just remember, I don't know, because like, you know, when I was a kid, my mom, it was just me and my mom for a while. So she works at like a swap meet place. So she works like from what, 10 to 7, get home like 8 p.m. So I had a lot of time to myself, I guess. And yeah, I just remember just like being very down. Like I'd have good days, but I just remember being very, like it only occurred to me maybe in the last couple of years seeing my nephews, seeing their kind of like demeanor. And I'm like, oh man, I felt so different when I was your age, you know? And I can't, like, in fact, when I see my nephews, I can't imagine them feeling like I felt when I was their age.
Well, what's their demeanor like?
Just like kids, happy and happy-go-lucky. I mean, who knows, maybe inside they're like in deep, deep turmoil, but...
Yeah.
And there's definitely stuff happening that we as adults like gloss over, but yeah, I don't know. But basically, I was trying to say that I had really bad grades in high school and I got kicked out and I had to like go through a secondary school program to get the credits. And then although I wanted to go to Art Center, I felt like I had to go to junior college first to get my general ed stuff. But I failed all of those and withdrew out of all of those. And so then I had to fix that and go to the night program at Art Center to sort of redeem myself. But then I failed those classes too.
Okay.
Yeah, so like...
Wait, but then, okay, so if you
I think my first application
okay.
to Art Center, I think I didn't get accepted because of my my junior college record, which I shouldn't have transcript, which I shouldn't have sent because it was just basically all like W's.
Okay.
Which W for withdrawal or failure, basically.
But then, okay, so if
at some point I got in, yeah.
I guess what I'm trying to get at is like, how did you get a full ride scholarship if you had poor grades in high school and in junior college into Art
Center? Because it's mostly based on portfolio. So I think the problem for me was the portfolio was fine, but the grades were bad. So they're like, just get your grades to an acceptable level to show us that you're like a passable human being because your work is fine. And then just, you know, it's all dependent also on like, you know, income levels and family incomes and stuff like that.
So, yeah.
And Art Center has a really good, or they did, I don't know about these days, but back then they had a pretty large endowment. There's like Cal Grant stuff, Pell Grant, whatever. There was a lot of financial aid. It was, mm-hmm. it was a lot of money in retrospect. Yeah. You know, really, it was like, I don't know.
I've been thinking a lot about traditional forms of education and, you know, the pitfalls of traditional forms of education. And there's certain things that are beneficial with these, you know, like going to elementary school, middle school, and high school and going to college. At some point, if you don't question why you're doing these things, then you kind of get lost in that mishmash of just having people tell you what to do.
Right, yeah. And going along for the ride. And for, you know, art programs, it's just really weird situation because on one hand, as a person, as a human being, you want, you kind of, especially at that age, you crave the structure and kind of like this temporary goal in life, right? Especially with art, because it's such a nebulous concept in the first place. But then art itself is really about, like, you know, exploration and taking risks. And it's really kind of like the opposite of school in a way, right? So it's like, you know what I mean? It's like show up every day to be random. You know what I mean?
What do you mean?
It's like...
You mean show up every day to art school?
So it's like the whole system. It's still a school. So you have like the whole like, you know, credit situation, grades, this whole like kind of system, and this kind of sense that there's that all of it somehow makes sense. But as an artist, like, I feel like a lot of the times like nothing makes sense. And as time goes on, things like school and grades and all that stuff, it seems more and more kind of like bizarre, like as if I was like an alien that, like, you know, like that landed here, and you're like, what? Like they get up every morning, you know, and line up in these rows in the class to do whatever. And, you know, art schools are about art, but they still have like syllabuses and grades and this totally like arbitrary kind of system, money, obviously. So
It's feeding the beast.
Yeah, it's a really weird thing. But on the other hand, you know, it supports a lot of artists, you know, teachers, right? And so it's like, I don't know.
Yeah,
it's a weird thing.
It's a complicated system. Yeah. There's no right way or wrong way to go about it, and we only have our opinions to that subject. I mean, I can, you know, when I was in college, I mean, I first went to college for business school, and then I took a couple photography classes. I took one, which I passed, and the second one I failed. Or I didn't fail, I just ended up dropping the class. Because I too thought...
That's the Steve Kim way.
Yeah. I was like, before I knew Steve Kim, I was like, you know what? This guy that I don't know named Steve Kim will probably want to drop out of this class that I'm taking right now. That's what I thought.
There you go.
Yeah. No, but I mean, I'm just trying to, you know, relate with you on the subject. It's like, it just seems so, there wasn't any sort of self-exploration within what I was getting taught. It was more so technical skills. And I was never really interested in technical skills, but at some point, I mean, you need to know like certain techniques, right, in order to like better your process, but it's not the only thing, if anything, right?
Yeah. It's, Art Center, I was in the illustration program, so they tend to be a little bit more, Art Center especially used to be very technical and very rigorous, you know, like you had to have chops for the ad industry or illustration industry. But over time, it's probably less of a trade school and more of a, especially with the, like their fine art program. So it was kind of like half and half. Not really as technical as, say, like workshops.
But do you still work as an illustrator?
Occasionally. Like, I did a piece for California Sunday Magazine. It's just kind of in the back of my mind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and when I, like right now, I kind of don't know what I want the work to look like. You know what I mean? You know, going back to those early drawing days when I was first figuring it out, I was like just literally creating like a illustration portfolio from scratch. And so all the pieces were small. I'd scan them in and try to figure something out. And I had a basic idea of what I wanted to do.
How long ago was that?
About 5 years ago, I think. Four or five years ago. Yeah, this was a year after grad school. And I thought, well, I'll just talk to my old illustration teachers or something, and then I'll get hooked up with, like, I don't know, however it works, which is not how it works. But, I mean, I don't know, like, for someone that really wasn't that heavy into the editorial illustration program at Art Center, once I started thinking about it on my own terms and, like, just kind of, like, hashing, you know, like hashing it out, like, what is an illustration? What is a client? What is an art director? What are their needs? Where... in what context would my work in, you know? And those were things that I just had never really thought about.
And during the grad program or directly after the grad program, you were thinking more so about that.
Yeah. So it was just like a brand new thing for me. And I was just thinking like, oh, maybe I'll paint, do some illustrations. They seem to kind of speak to each other in general. You know, made my website and sent some emails out. And I got some work like that for a while. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I was like terrified. I was like, because even in like the illustration classes, I never really paid attention, or I didn't take them really. I was more interested in painting back then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh. That sounds interesting. It sounds like my approach to schooling. Because when I was in elementary school, I was pretty much a straight A student. And yeah. then after that, in high school and college, I mean, I was like a B student. I got like 3.0 GPA or 3.2 or something. But it wasn't a main focus, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Even in school, it was really weird because I would be a student, but extremely critical of the whole situation, and especially mm-hmm. like instructors, how I would teach differently or how it should be and blah, blah, blah. But I was still like part of that current, right? Like in terms of, because this is before YouTube and stuff. So compared to now, I think like if you're a young person now, I feel like you can basically learn whatever you want or do whatever you want. But back then, for me at least, I just, if somehow I could have made that leap, like that cognitive leap, like, oh, I can figure things out on my own, the way I learned to draw, the way I learned to do like computery 3D stuff or whatever. But if I could apply that kind of like mindset to my entire life, then I probably would have like left school, middle school, high school. Like,
yeah.
What's the point of going to high school if you mean I know that, exactly what I want to do, you know?
Uh-huh. You mean exploring different mediums and applying that idea of exploring different mediums
just applying
into your
that
life?
Into life in general. In other words, like there's this kind of like binary between creativity and the arts and say something like business or whatever. But when I look at like the business side, like say you're just like making sprockets or whatever, and like, well, that's not creative. But then you look at the logistics and you look at say marketing or whatever, that person, those people may not see themselves as creative people, but it's a creative process because you're like literally, especially if you're just like a self-starter or whatever, you're just figuring things out on your own. So that mentality of like, I got this or I'll figure it out or whatever, like,
you like, mean the confidence?
Yeah, yeah. But I didn't have that at all as a student, you know?
Yeah.
So I was just always like flip-flopping between what I wanted to do and then going along for the ride and getting away and yeah. not going to class. And
I know what you mean. Stuff. Yeah, but yeah. I think a lot of people, artists or just people in general, like maybe in their early 20s, you're just discovering things. And I think that discovery, like, keeps on getting more fluid and you start understanding yourself more. But I think that's just part of the growing process. It's just part of the process of understanding yourself. And, you know, I can say now I'm much more confident in my artistic practice than I was 5 years ago. Personally, 5 years ago, I felt kind of lost.
Right.
You know, I didn't know, you know, I wanted to do some commercial stuff, but I didn't want to label myself as a commercial photographer. And I felt like I had more
right,
to say.
Right, yeah.
Did you feel that way?
Oh,
I mean,
I remember having a conversation about like to my instructors, like, because one of them had like a, it was really weird. Like one of them like changed their name, I think, to do like another illustration. Like he was already an illustrator and he wanted to change his style. So he adopted another name or something.
Yeah, and he rebranded himself essentially.
Yeah, and which is like, but it wasn't really that different. It was still within like this certain kind of like, I don't know, illustration-y look or whatever. And I was thinking like, so I would ask instructors, well, what if I want to be a fine artist and illustrate at the same time? Would I need to have like a pseudonym or whatever? And a lot of them were like, yeah, you don't want to do both, or you want to like keep those separate or apart.
But isn't that kind of an old world approach?
Yeah, well,
to
that's
things?
The thing. It's like I didn't realize that I were talking to people that were, you know, they were older.
Yeah,
they were teaching in the illustration program, but not necessarily, but most likely not working as illustrators. Because
yeah.
this is Art Center's West Coast, so it doesn't have that editorial illustration, commercial illustration kind of side of things as much as like SVA or schools in New York. LA is a little bit more, the illustration program is more about like either entertainment, this was like, you know, a long time ago, but more like entertainment and more like yeah. maybe like lowbrow gallery stuff, you know?
Well, it could just be the generation in which you went to Art Center. I don't know who really teaches at Art Center now, but you know, I have this theory about, I mean, it's not really a theory. It's more so just about mentorship, finding certain people. And because of the internet, it's easy to like essentially get mentored by people that you really admire. But I think the idea of mentorship is and getting taught by people that you really admire is much more important than just learning from some random professor. Because, you know, generally speaking, these professors are taking these jobs to make a living. But, you know, when you're teaching or when you're doing teaching full time, then it takes away from what you're actually trying to do professionally as like a working artist, right?
Right.
So I don't know. I mean, it's... yeah, I think it's hard to see that when you're in it, when you're actually a student.
Oh, sure, sure. And I think it's like, unless you're like really, really, really inquisitive about like structural systems or something, like as a high schooler, which I guess nowadays there's more of that thanks to YouTube and all that. For me, it's like completely invisible. Like it didn't even occur to me, but it's only until like, until now, it's like just all the things that go into these systems, you know, like working in. Sustaining themselves, because like you can have like, say, like in an ideal case, you have like, you know, a super spirited great teacher, right? And maybe he'll feel that way this first 6 months, and then over time burn out or whatever, or just stop caring or whatever, you know, that person's still going to be employed unless something really bad happens, right? You know, because he or she's going to have their friends within the program, with, you know, administration, things like that. And that's all invisible to a student. And as a student, you don't know, like, how would you know what is good instruction? What is good art even? Mm-hmm. What is relevancy? Is there such a thing if someone shows, like, what kind of shows? Like, you know, as a student, I would remember, like, looking at instructors' work or their, like, CVs or whatever. And just the fact that they exhibited, right? It was like, whoa.
Yeah.
They showed at the thing. What's the show? I don't know, but they showed, right? Yeah. So it creates this mental picture that people capitalize on, not just schools in these larger programs, but like workshops or whatever. We're all trying to sell something, right?
So. No, it's interesting because one of the main professors when I was in college, he was a commercial photographer, but he had like his portfolio was from the 80s, and there was all these really old, like really shittily lit, I don't know, like cars or something,
right,
or some sort of commercial projects. And I was thinking to myself, do I really want to learn from this guy? You know?
That was smart of you, probably.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I ended up dropping out of, not changing my major over to photography, because I felt, you know, it's interesting because, well, for a photographer, you can learn a lot on the field if you just apprentice under people, but you also don't want to get underneath that, you know, people call it like the assistant trap, where you just continually like assist and light for people.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And, I mean, this is more so on the commercial side, you know, not so much on like the fine art photography side, but I think it's, that could be said, you know, with, just any sort of like educational thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Right? I think that can just happen just in general. Just, like you have to be the person that other people want, essentially. Right. So if you're always assisting, they don't know you exist in the first place.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, there's a lot of great things that come from like mentorships and things like that. But as an assistant, at the same time, you definitely have to be building your own kind of like name or whatever,
for
reputation,
sure.
Stuff like that. So it's a great way to, I would say it's a pretty, in commercial work, a great way to like get your foot in the door or whatever.
Yeah. It is, as long as you understand the intention and the reason why you're continuing to assist for people. This is actually why, like, I started interviewing painters and essentially people who take an idea from their mind and then put it on a paper, or put it on a canvas or something, is because with photography and commercial photography, you can essentially, you actually don't necessarily need to know anything about lighting. Generally, like the really, really good commercial photographers, they do know a bunch about lighting. But sometimes they bring in these assistants that just know everything about lighting.
Oh, really?
And then they just light their set, and then you're essentially a button clicker at that point.
Right. Because it's, I pay attention to a lot of photography.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Like, it's always been something kind of, because my work depends so much on photography, you know, everything is photo reference. I've always been a kind of like a camera person.
I can see that.
Just spending way too much on tripods I never use.
Really?
Yeah, it's really ridiculous.
I can see that. You're a highly technical person. From my interaction with you, you're very technical, but you also like dissect that process as well. Because you explore these different trajectories.
Just, yeah, right. Yeah, it's just like you get fixated with things. So like for something like a tripod, you start researching like, how do you get the most stable, lightweight, you know, whatever. And you just start like diving into that stuff. And like I spent like about a year almost just getting to art reproduction. Like I was trying to figure out how to reproduce my oil paintings. And so just that one question led me to like not just cameras, but like color science, raw development, lighting, spectral analysis, because every light
art reproduction. What do you mean?
Taking a photo of an oil painting. It's really tricky, you know?
Oh, I see what you mean. Oh, okay.
So I just wanted to do that. And then, but that led to all these other things that I had to figure out. And there's no, you can sort of Google it. There was Google back then. But a lot of it is just like trial and error and like a quasi-scientific method, you know? So yeah. All that stuff, I think it works a part of your brain or something. And and also just practically it's useful. Like I don't have a real, I would have to buy at least one more lens if I really wanted to get back into that thing. Cause I haven't done like, other than the Red Bull stuff, I haven't done large scale oil paintings. I just,
why would you have to buy another lens though?
Cause what I was doing was stitching about 16 to 20 photos together. And so the more you crop into a painting, the wider the field of view, I think. So there's just a lot of distortion. So you want a long lens, ideally a macro. So you have basically when you're lighting artwork, you want to get the camera as far as away from the painting because that narrows your family of angles, right? So you won't see light glare and stuff. Mm-hmm. Obviously you can adjust the lights and things, but generally you want to get away from the painting. And so,
but do you find an excitement in that or does that process frustrate you?
It's like both.
Yeah.
It's like it's like really wanting to figure things out so I can not like think about it again. So like I try to like figure out a way to have like the foolproof method of like art repro. But in the end, it was really just easier to eyeball things. So that's, you know, after I scan it, I have like a setup and everything's calibrated and stuff. But still, in the end, because the way light interacts with, say, a gouache painting versus a drawing versus matte board, it's going to always fluctuate. So in the end, you still got to eyeball stuff, you know?
I'm curious how do you, I have a couple questions, but how do you describe your artwork to someone who's never seen your artwork? I think this is the first time that I've actually asked someone this.
Oh, really?
I'm curious. Yeah.
I'd just be as like banal or simple about it. Just like, they're just like drawings, paintings, figurative, because there isn't a lot of like, there's not like a story. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, like a direct narrative.
Yeah,
to it.
Yeah, there, yeah. So, I would just skirt around the question, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess it depends who's asking too, because then you have to understand the person's knowledge of like artwork or their interest in artwork too.
Yeah, and it's like, I mean, the work, you know, it's a lot of different stuff, right? There's oil paintings. Sometimes they're more abstract. Sometimes they're a bit more representational. They're drawings. Like I would say, like with each medium, it's like, you know, like you can have an artist that has like a style, right? Or a thing that they do. And so whether it's like they can make a watercolor look like their oil painting and vice versa, you know, you can see the connection between say their graphite drawing or oil painting or acrylic. It's basically all the same.
Do you see the connection between all of the different mediums that you use?
Yeah, so whereas with me, like I would say that the medium dictates things more, right? So like as soon as I'm working, say on paper, I'm thinking about paper stuff. If I'm drawing, I'm thinking about what can you do with drawing, watercolor, etc. Mm-hmm. It it kind of takes over, you know, and because it's presenting a different set of variables, different ideas, and you see different things in it. You know what I mean? Like I could brute force, say, a watercolor into this highly rendered oil painting, which is in itself interesting. But in the meantime, it's doing all this other stuff. And let me take care of this first. Like there's definitely like, you know, all the technical stuff we were talking about, like there's definitely like end game, you know, like at some point, like, okay, I could sort of kind of figure things out here. I could get better at it, but it's like, it would take a lot more effort and time. And, you know, like I got the gist of it or whatever. So with each medium, each subject, there's always that kind of like initial kind of like, how like, curve or something, like learning curve, where it's like the most steep, and then at some point you start seeing yourself doing the same things, like you start seeing the patterns within your own work or whatever, and you start wanting to branch out.
What patterns you see in your own work over the course of time? Is there any sort of reoccurring structures or reoccurring thoughts or reoccurring philosophies?
I think the reoccurring philosophy, I guess, this sort of like avoidant thought, like wanting to get away from things. So in other words, like I think most people, if they go to like museums and shows and things, it should be inspirational. And it is to a certain extent, but it also like, it's really like also really aggravating because for me, in my mind, I can feel something in my brain saying, this is how things should be, right? Like even if I...
You mean when you go to a different museum show?
Yeah, yeah. It just creates this kind of like... It's just a social kind of part of how we're wired, right? Like, I don't think if you're like a citizen, like during like Nazi Germany or some totalitarian like whatever thing, I don't think the average person is like, how can it be a horrible person? But you're surrounded by certain ideas, and they kind of like they just like it changes you or whatever. I don't know how I got.
I see what you mean. No, I think you're using that example because you know you have your own particular perspective on how art is or like what you like within art and your own artwork, right?
Yeah, but I don't think it's that great. You know, it's like I'm not. You know, it's oh, you know what it is. Just how I was thinking about it. I feel like you know, if a person can really say like feel really good about themselves, then I think they can do really well. So in other words, if they say, I want to be an artist and make a painting and then it shows, like it sells or it shows or something, and then they can get use that fact to like as proof that they're a great person, right? So as they get better and better and more famous or whatever, it's like all this, the shows and exhibitions, that's all proof that I am this amazing artist person, right? Genius person. And with that thought, I think a person can really do a lot of amazing things, right? And so is that person really a genius? I don't know. But like just having that like that mindset, even if it's delusional, right? Like I think you can do a lot of cool things. But I don't I have less of that, I think. And so I don't know if they're accomplishments or not, but it just sort of like, it's like kind of cool for a second and then just kind of lands with a thud and I have to like start over and like rebuild and be like, well, what do I really want to do? You know? So.
Well, yeah, no, I think there's those checks and balances. And I think in order to have a healthy mindset, there needs to be an equal amount of positive and equal amount of negative criticism, you know, because if you're completely positive and you're completely thinking like basically your shit don't stink, and you think all of your artwork is amazing, then, you know, maybe outside of yourself.
But that's
right?
The thing. It's like, I really do feel like, you know, to a certain extent, like if you have that like energy or whatever, and you can especially have other people buy into that and have a following or have that reputation. I mean, I think, you know, to a large extent, you know, like maybe with the photography side, especially with photography, I think about that, or like conceptual artists or something. It's about the cachet, right? The name, the brand, or whatever. So yeah, like if you have like people, if you have that name, if someone knows you because some other person knows you, and a lot of people know you, that's like, then it's like gravy, because you can make can make whatever, and then the spectator, the viewer, they have their own imaginations. They'll see things in the work. They'll like idolize or whatever.
I see what you mean. But I think to a certain extent that could be a character flaw too, because you know.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's great. I'm just saying I'm just speculating.
Well, because I mean, just using it as an example, like some artists out there, outsider perspective, can look at your work and they're like, oh wow, this guy's really amazing, and you inspire something out of this artist, right?
Right.
But conversely, I mean, you can look at someone else's artwork and, you know, maybe you think, you know, either they're great, like conceptually, or maybe you think they're great because of like their business mindset or whatever, or maybe it's a combination of both. But I think there's always those, I mean, unless you're like at the very, very top, you know, if you're like a blue chip artist or something, but even then it's like, you get presented with these other humanistic struggles, you know? So I don't know if that ever ends, but I think it's just about really understanding like the reason why you're doing the thing that you're doing within your artwork and trying to find some sort of semblance with that and be able to make money from that process.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. I mean, there is, I mean, I'm not trying to be like super cynical about it, you know. I'm just trying to describe like what I see as just like natural phenomenon, you know, or phenomena. Like for instance, like since I always do this, like it's always been this kind of like scraping by freelance, occasional art sale, art show kind of life. So when I see someone with like, when I just even think of like, say, a steady paycheck or the day job or whatever, I create within myself this whole like kind of like fantastical kind of like narrative, right? And it creates this kind of like picture in your mind, right? And I was just
what thinking, sort of picture does it create?
Just something like better than what I have, or a better life, or the right life, or the good life, or whatever. What everything that I'm not but should be, or whatever. Envy, jealousy, things like that. So like I was just, you know, I was like, you know, I'm not really a bar person, for example, but this idea of like, say, a guy in a suit, you know, like end of the day, you know, loosening his tie at the bar, drinking his drink, you know, maybe, you know, whatever, doing that whole thing, that is like there's like this whole like, you know, romantic kind of like picture in my mind, right? But that same person walking by, say, my show and seeing me or an artist or whatever, they see that, and then they're going to have this crazy idea of what that must be like, that life or whatever. And I can't speak to like the highest high end of things, but just even a regular show or even like a solo show, or, like it's a thing, but it's not that, like in a way, a business person or a non-artist looking at artistic endeavors, that's in a way far more creative than actual artwork, that picture they create in their mind, you know, of what life must be for other people. And this is just like, this is just how we engage, right? This is, you know, when we look at other people, other lives, you know, there's like this highly imaginative / creative, you know.
Do you think about that a lot?
Yeah, I'd say so, yeah. It's, I mean, like, part of it's just because of all the social network stuff, you know? So I feel like just having an Instagram account is like, you're like subscribing to like an online social studies, social media program. You know what I mean? Like,
is that why you didn't follow people for a long time?
Yeah, sort of.
No, I mean, I think that's totally fine. You know, I think sometimes, you know, looking at other people's artwork or looking at other people's lives in general, it can be inundating.
Yeah, I felt like kind of like pushed around by the things I was seeing, and I didn't feel like I had a good grasp on things. And you know, in terms of social media and all that stuff, I've always been pretty kind of late to the game, even though I've been on the internet forever. Just in general, I think about that stuff a lot, I guess.
Yeah.
Or just what drives people, and I don't know, like when you just like how we were saying like earlier about school, like you have these kind of preconceptions or misconceptions. And then, but you don't realize you have them until after the fact. And so those same kind of misconceptions, kind of, they're everywhere in everything, right? So it's always like, oh, I was wrong about this, I was wrong about that, I was wrong about that, I was wrong about that. So like, what is right, or what am I okay with?
Yeah. Well, then what are you right about?
So yeah, so it's mostly thinking about like just what do I want to do? What do I want the work to be about? There's a lot of thinking about like subject matter, medium,
but materials. What do you want the work to be about? Like, what do you think your work encapsulates? Is there a specific? I know it's a complicated topic because I don't know if how I would be able to tell someone what my work's about.
Right. Yeah.
Yet we're here talking about what your work's about.
It's just hard because, like, you know, I just don't have that like that narrative, you know, like or identity as much. Like, I have an identity, like it's there, but I'm like always trying to get rid of it or trying to like start over or detach. Like, I was thinking like one day with my friend, like, would you prefer to have, like, languages are really cool. So we all have, you know, all the different languages of the world or whatever. But what if we all had a unified language where we could all, you know, understand each other, but we'd have to get rid of all these kind of idiosyncratic individual, like Korean, Japanese, whatever. And she had her native language and she was like, no way, I'd never do that because it's too important to me. Whereas, you know, Korean's cool, English is cool, but, you know, whatever is the most like unified where everyone can speak to each other, you just get used to that. And for me, the pros outweigh the cons. Do you know what I mean? Like this idea of individuality or idiosyncrasies, like for me, it addresses this kind of larger issue of othering, right? Like as soon as you have like language problems, then othering becomes a real problem, right? You can't understand each other. I mean, a lot of people speak the same language, but because we see each other as different, you see different things, you know. Mm-hmm.
But I mean, would that really change? Because I mean, I think we're still talking about humanistic characteristics. So if we all had essentially, let's say everyone spoke English.
Yeah.
There would still be.
Which we do in America, obviously, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, even when during the time of the Neanderthals and cavemen, you know, people were expressing themselves with these interesting looking like stick figures and through body language. But I guess what I'm trying to say is that there's all these forms of communication, but I don't think that if we had one singular language that things would be communicated. I mean, even your artwork, like we're talking about your artwork, and that is a communication within itself. You're communicating something maybe deeper that you don't necessarily, that you can't tangibly discuss, but you discuss it simply by creating these pieces.
Right. So I guess I mean more in terms of like identity. Like, cause I mean, you know, I'm, I don't know if you're, this is, how do you say this without offending too many people? Okay, as a Korean Asian American, right, I'm like, it's like a quasi minority status. Like within the arts, there's a lot of like identity politics where someone will want to talk specifically about their identity, their struggles as a certain race or whatever, which is of course perfectly fine. But what I'm saying is that I'm sure it affects me one way or another, but like if that aspect of myself just evaporated, it just doesn't bother me. In other words, I would rather be able to speak to another person through, say, like a universal language or whatever, than as me, Steve Kim, as an American, and you as this other person as a, I don't know, Frenchman or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like the American aspect, the French, the Cambodian, you know, like that, those things are like, it's kind of like minutiae, you know, which is, I think, you know, really offenses would be really, understandably really offensive to people because it's like their heritage and their identity. Mm-hmm. But I guess it's just like this weird kind of like, life feels arbitrary to begin with. So the fact that I'm one thing or another, like that's arbitrary too. So I can't, like, there's not much in me that can really like, grab onto that. Do you know what I mean? So
I see what you mean.
Yeah. So like even like with the artwork and the subject matter and all that, it's like those things happened, you know, like I happened to like kind of draw a certain way or subject matter wise draw certain things like the figure. But I in the back of my mind, I'm always feeling like it could have gone any other way and it can go in any other way. And that's probably the most interesting part. And when I feel the most uncomfortable is when I start feeling like I'm navigating between like these kind of like invisible forces, you know, like something feels wrong, but I don't know exactly what. And I feel like I'm being kind of sort of like pushed around by like, you know, societal expectations or what is good, what is bad or whatever. Like, I mean, grad school was really tough too, because there's just something in the water, you know, like amongst your peers and friends. And
what's that something in the water?
This kind of like like shared value. Like, we as a group of grad students, as artists, this is what we feel is good art and bad art. And so like, this constant conversation as to what's good, what's bad, high and low and all that. And that whole, it just kind of like made me feel like really uncomfortable. And like, even, you know, I have a few like acquaintances and friends from that time, but just like, I'm glad it's over. And I wouldn't do it again, really, to be honest, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's interesting, you know, doing these, you know, when you're in art school, doing like a group critique of someone's work, because there's certain people that you value their opinion and there's other people that you don't value their opinion. And then when it all gets mixed in there, then you're just kind of like, okay, well, what's the point of critiquing my work when I value this person's opinion and I don't necessarily value this person's opinion, right?
Right, yeah.
But I mean, I understand what you mean, because then with all those opinions within the room, and it's more of like a character or like human study,
right?
Human behavioral study of like how people's, it's almost like the Stanford prison experiment or something, but obviously less violent. We're talking about art, but it's like how these humanistic characteristics start morphing themselves into each other because we're in this group. You know, I think what you're talking about is you're, you know, you have your own opinion and you've been molding this opinion of what art and what you like about art is for a long time, right?
Yeah. I mean, I feel like it's always been there, you know, even when I was like, I mean, I remember like as a kid, like maybe not, like, you know, I'd go to my mom's shop to help out, and I would always feel like I was being like exploited or like wasting my life and wasting my time, because I knew I had...
What this, shop was it?
It's just like, she does like embroidery and alterations, so I'd help out. It's like a swap meet kind of thing, you know? Like, you know what?
Oh, it's like tailoring.
Yeah, yeah. So like embroidery and handling a lot of garments and things like that. And I would help out with the... It's like a Korean-owned business kind of thing. And I would just always remember thinking like, I should be working on this other more important stuff. My work, even as a very young person, before I don't know if I even identified as an artist or anything like that. And I just remembered like, this is a very clear memory of being like 11 years old, because I was telling myself, okay, Steve, you're 11. It's time to get serious about this art stuff. And kind of like trying to like, you know, like, you know, like hype myself up, right? But then go home and just like, watch cartoons or whatever. So
do you think that approach still happens now that you're older?
Yeah, I think it's...
Or do you feel more disciplined?
I think it's been a slow process for me. Like sometimes I see other people and I feel like they just like pick it up right away. But for me, it's definitely a slower process.
But I think that's just perception.
No, because I can look at like the work that I liked and that I was producing relative to my peers at the same like age or whatever, and like, you know, my work was really bad like for a long time. It wasn't until mid-20s that I felt like I was maybe kind of had an eye for a certain thing. I went to Art Center partially because I wanted to like make spaceships and creature designs or whatever, even though I never did. It was just part of, it was what I was looking at. I was looking at a lot of entertainment art, illustration, things like that.
Well, but I think it's hard for people, you know, not everyone comes out as a fully formed artist.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
It's very rare, and you know.
So I guess like I would say that now that process is more clear, right?
Yeah.
It's like more aware of like all these different things kind of pushing in, pulling at me, and what correlates with what, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Versus I guess when you're younger, you kind of don't know why you're being like pushed into that this or that direction, and there's a lot of, I mean, you're never free of it, you know, like I don't
You sure? Because I feel like you can be free of it.
No, if you're like, maybe if you're like hardcore, like Buddhist or Zen or whatever, which I was kind of into for a while. But then the thing is, like, after a while, like mindfulness stuff or Buddhist stuff starts feeling a little too Buddhist-y. Do you know what I mean? Like, it starts feeling too specific and idiosyncratic. And so it just like starts aggravating me. So there's a period of time when mindfulness practice and like Dharma talks and all that stuff, I was like soaking it in, right? That at a certain point, it's like you harden or something, and you like as soon as I try to listen to one now, and as soon as I listen, and they have that super soft, like, you know, meditative voice, like, and just like just everything about it starts feeling like contrivance, even though the whole practice is about being, you know, genuine and stuff like that. So I'm not trying to knock on it. I'm just saying, like, this is what I experience. Yeah. And it's like, it's aggravating. I don't know why. It's just one of those things. Like,
yeah.
One way I can put it or describe it, because I think about time travel a lot.
Okay.
So
like Back to the Future time travel, or?
Yeah, like if you're not, it's that whole like arbitrary thing, the whole thing about arbitrariness, like you just happen to be born in a certain time. Now we have like iPhones, internet and shit. But like, you know, say like you're really into music and you're really into, I like hip hop a lot or rap or whatever. But what if you went back into time for whatever reason, into like, I don't know, Mozart days and stuff? And the thing is, like, if that really happened, how like almost like nightmarish it would be, especially if you're, say, like a musician's musician, because then you would be surrounded with people that were like, dude, that's cello, right? Nothing wrong with cellos and nothing wrong with, like, you know, whatever classical music is about. But like, if that was... Mm-hmm. Everything. So no matter who you spoke to, they would always be talking about that cello, right? And whereas, like, you know, well, what about like electronic music or beats or well, or stuff like, yeah, that? You'd be like, you'd be like in this prison, and say then you wanted to participate in that world with all this knowledge that you accrued. People would just be like, "What is this crap? It's like noise. It's like, you know what I mean? It's like this weird, like almost like like Twilight Zone nightmare scenario."
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is, like we're all in that now, in a way. We're all those classical musician loving people, except instead of classical music, it's, you know, contemporary art. It's all the various kind of scenes that we're into and identify with. But, you know, if someone like some future art connoisseur came to today's days, they'd be like frustrated because like you guys are still stuck with this like abstraction, pseudo abstraction painting. It's all about whatever. Do you know what I mean?
Do you think about time travel a lot in regards to your artwork?
It's not like literally thinking about, like, I'm not literally like trying to build a time machine.
No, I know that.
But it's like a it's like a tool. Or like koan, you know, like it's like this thing, this mechanism that you think about to reassess reality, I guess. You know what I mean?
Hmm. Okay.
Yeah. So like it's like, so, and so like, for example, like if we're all like enmeshed in this culture of ours, like, is there a way to extract yourself from it? Do you even want to? Like, what are like the social forces at work? You know, like I was just... The other day, I was like, a lot of times I forget how big the world is because I live in a small town, right? And I'm basically a hermit, essentially. And I forget how big the art world is because I'm like stressing over, like, you know, my pretty like affordable art artwork, right? But there's a whole world out there where you're talking about like millions and millions of dollars and. And I forget that aspect, that even exists, because why would anyone even want to buy art? Why would anyone even care? And things like that. Like, what is the intrinsic value of art? Does it even exist? And then the other day I was looking at this about this like Bitcoin speculation, you know? So people are going crazy about...
electronic currency?
Yeah, and flipping it or investing or not. And like just billions, maybe just lots and lots of money. and lots of human energy focused on what is essentially like doesn't even exist, and yet there's this interest in it.
Yeah.
And then the thing that actually that made me the happiest in with regards to art and being an artist is like, well, if people can be so invested in like this Bitcoin stuff or stocks or whatever that they can't even own or possess or look at or whatever, just so they can profit from it, then, you know, what if maybe that's really the ultimate, like, that's really how, like, you know, artwork, you know, at the high end levels, it's just like, it's a speculative product that you can invest early, and when the culture kind of like agrees, the prices go up, and then you can sell it and make a profit. And I was thinking, like, if my art could function in that way, like, it makes me happier for some reason.
Yeah.
You know, because then, because that seems more real than this kind of like day to day art idea of like personal value. I'm an artist, I have a message, I have a thing, I'm better than you, you know, like,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think we're talking about just human behavior. And there's almost this, what you're talking about, I feel like, is this technological analysis paralysis, where because you have access to all the information on your smartphone, you can literally look up anything. And then because of that, you know, think of even the time travel example, you know, people 300 years ago, they had no idea about what technology is. Even thinking about the word technology, I'm curious what that even meant back to someone 300 or 400 years ago, right?
Yeah, a wheel.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah. Imagine this new wheel that they made out of wood.
So round, dude.
What's wood? But I guess what I'm trying to say is that, you know, I think you have a very unique perspective, and it comes out through your artwork. It sounds like, do you get analysis paralysis thinking about different ideas? I mean, even when we were talking about the tripod, you know, and that could be a whole entire study, like a year long study of which tripod is the most stable.
Right. So I'd say that I've, you know, analyzed to a certain extent the analysis, right? The meta analysis, right? So I know when I'm like, I have a general feeling of when I'm like going kind of like in this kind of paralysis side of things, or when it feels generative, and like there's types of research that really, where you feel like you're going in the right direction. And because in the end, it doesn't matter what it is, like technical or whatever, it's all subjective experience, you know? Like if I start talking about like materials or engineering or whatever of tripods, like, yeah, sure, like engineering minded people will be like, yeah, that's my jam or whatever. But it's still subjective experience, you know, like math or numbers or technical things. It's still, you still have to feel all that stuff, right? So, I mean, that's all we like have, right? Like, that's like the measure of every kind of like action or production or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so I think what you find a lot in creativity or in arts where things are so nebulous, you start looking for those touchstones, right? Because you're not sure how you feel. You're not even sure if you're feeling, right? Because someone, you know, if I said to someone else, you know, all these objective things, math, science, numbers, like they're incredibly subjective, and they'll be like, what are you talking about? This is, you know, the scientific method, this is objectivity, etc. So there'd be a big like issue, right? With regards to touchstones, I think that's how we have these kind of like tribes and disciplines and value. It's like, as an artist, you feel like, I don't know what I feel like I should be doing something, but I don't know. Well, I can't pick my major or whatever. But you want to be like good. You want to be important. You want to be special. You want to be better, especially better, right? You want to be better than the other person.
That's natural human competitiveness. Yeah,
so that's the feeling that's there. It's like, how do you get there? How do you be the thing? And a lot of it is in terms of like, I think a lot of it is like in terms of just consumerism, right? Like, I'm not anti-consumer, anti-capital, but like literally you can buy things that let you be a part of the tribe or the club or whatever. And I think that functions in a similar way with just ideas, you know, in terms of aesthetics and, you know, this is the good art. This is the, these are the good ideas. These are the good, this is the right ideology. And then you could like, yeah, that's good. And now I look better in front of other people. And that whole process is, you know, just natural.
Yeah, but you're not in control of that process either.
Yeah. I mean, I think you can be like aware of it to a certain extent if you want to be, or if you just happen to be.
Well, you can manipulate it.
Yeah.
Or you can manipulate your artwork to fit within the realm of what's popular.
But I think that...
I'm not saying that's a good thing.
Right, yeah. But I think that is kind of, it can be difficult. It just depends on the person. Like some people they just really seem to be able to, like, say if they're really into a certain art movement, they just kind of, they just seem to pick it up or integrate, you know what I mean? Really well.
Well, people are just opportunists and they want to capitalize on what's popular.
No, but I think, I mean, those guys, I don't really understand anyways, but I think like, you know, if you have this kind of like anxiety as an artist, you know, I think it's natural then to seek some kind of like refuge, something you can be a part of, something that kind of gives you some kind of structure. And I think that's fine. But I also think that it can kind of be a little like uneasy. Like I see this especially in terms of style discussions, like when people are like, I haven't found my style yet. I've been working on my style, and like, I have no idea what this means. Like, how does, what are you saying, right? But for them, it's something that makes sense because they have this idea that there's this thing that they can go to obtain, to get, versus something that just happens, just something that literally just is there, that just emanates from you, right? And then as you follow that impulse, then you have this somewhat, quote-unquote, style, you know, or something recognizable or a pattern or whatever, you know? So it's like this causation or correlation, like the direction of causation, right? So there's this idea, like, especially in our culture, it's like what we want, you know, to be fit or to be, like, rich, to be this or that, like, we just need to do the thing that that person's doing. So in other words, we see the runner, we see the athlete, and then I'm going to go running, or I'm going to be an athlete, or I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. But more likely is that person just felt like running, or he felt like competing, or he felt like he had that impulse, that drive. And as a result, his body and his mind and his reflexes kind of created that thing, right? So aping the movement, aping the action, like, it helps to a certain extent. But I think more interesting is, like, what is that, like, how do you, like, say if you're out of shape and you want to be in shape, or you want to be like that, like, runner or whatever, what are the conditions that created that? You know what I mean? So it's like...
So what you're saying is, through the process of doing something, let's take athletics, for example.
Yeah.
You know, you're running, and then you become fit because you're running and you're eating right.
Yeah.
Right? There's a direct effect that happens because of that. But with artwork, it's not that simple. You know, there's not a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5-step process. It's kind of like this, you can't really pinpoint it that easily. You know, you can't intake a certain amount of calories amount.
Well, what I mean in terms of that is, I guess it's in a more simple way to phrase it. It's like, so that there's this idea that we exercise in order to be healthy, when it's really more likely that we're healthy and so we exercise, right? We're healthy and we feel good and we're happy, and that's what like, if I'm, you know, have a lot of energy, I start running, like, spontaneously, like, you know, it doesn't happen often, as you can tell, but like Forrest Gump, just like, just run out the house and go, just because you want to, right? So I think, you know, whether it's an oversimplification or not, you know, I think, you know, all activity, all processes, living processes, just is that, you know, like, you're healthy, your brain is working, your body's working, your emotions are functioning, your curiosity is engaged or whatever. And from that, you have excess something, right? If it's excess physical energy, then it's converted into running or exercise or whatever. Mm-hmm. And if it's like excess energy in the form of like curiosity or building or making, then it's going to like start looking for an outlet. But I guess there's a difference between And for some people, that outlet, like for some people, that outlet, it can be just something that's already, that pre-exists, like woodworking or traditional papermaking or whatever. Yeah. And some people, that's not enough and they have to keep looking for that different thing, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think you're more so on that end of the spectrum, right? Constantly looking for that next thing, the next thing that you can be curious about. But I think what we're talking about is that there's certain people...
But I don't want to make it like a good or bad thing, you know?
No, I understand, yeah. But we're just illustrating all of the ideologies behind why people get into certain things, right? So yeah. Some people are into artwork for the wrong reasons. Maybe it's an ego thing, and maybe it's more so about, you know,
but don't you think like it's all an ego thing? Like we're all in it for the wrong reasons, right? Like
I don't know about it. I don't know. I don't think so.
I'm a lot more like pessimistic than you are.
I don't know. I don't know if that's easily quantifiable, you know, in terms of who's pessimistic and who's not pessimistic.
Right, sure.
But I don't know. I think about that a lot, about why do we do No Wave? Why do I do Artist Decoded? Why do I do photographs and stuff? And
right.
And
but it's like a question that you can't answer just with thought alone, right? It's like you have to, you know, for whatever, like...
Well, it's thought and process.
Yeah, and you may not know exactly why, but you know that you have to at least do it in order to, like, kind of, like, get somewhere with that thing. Even if you don't have the ultimate, like, answer, or you're left with more questions or whatever, but you know, at the very least, I want to do this podcast... Or I have this idea. I don't know why, but in order to at least have a semblance of of why, I have to do the thing itself, right? I think that kind of thing just happens more or less spontaneously, you know? Like, I think everyone has these things that just kind of, like, captivate them, that kind of, like, fix their interests. And I think, you know, if there is failure in the system, it's that this is not something that's even really talked about or addressed. And so what happens is that you have this young, virile, energetic, enthusiastic young person, a nebulous, right, inchoate, just formless. But because they live in this time, in this era, this country, with this family, and this family's expectations, society, et cetera, that very large, vague, broad thing starts to get like a river or like tributaries or whatever, starts to get funneled in certain paths, you know? And if they're lucky, I guess they'll find like artisanal spoon making or something, and that'll be their life's work or whatever. But I think more than likely in that process, a lot gets lost. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
because if you say you have like 100% theoretical creative energy, like young person energy. That's whatever. Mm-hmm. Whenever I see young people, I'm like, man, they got so much energy.
Well, it's not only young people, but
sure. And in fact, old people too. Whenever I see my mom, she's like 60, 70. Like, man, you got so much, like, get up and go. But that's just me. Anyways, what I'm saying is, like, say you have like 100% of this theoretical energy. And then because you're born in the time and place you're born in, you can be a lawyer, doctor, or let's say artist, right? I think that if those are your only three options, that 100% in trying to figure out if you want to be a lawyer, doctor, or artist, like that stuff starts leaking out, or you start losing something. Something fundamentally changes unless you're super duper lucky. And most likely, you lose something that you don't even realize you've lost. Do you know what I mean? And so that's why you can have, you know, doctors or lawyers that do really weird, heinous shit, right? Because this vocation, this job, this set of like knowledge and behavior, it's not enough. It's just a small subset of what a person is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And just because you go to art school or you identify as an artist or you want to be an artist doesn't mean you don't have these same constrictive
substrates.
Yeah, that are like kind of like acting on you. And where are you going to talk about that, right? Like if you're like at a maybe like, I don't know, like meditation retreat, you know, those guys are going to think in terms of the stuff that they talk about, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, but I see what you're saying, but I guess the point that I'm trying to illustrate is that people get into things all the time for the wrong reasons. You know, maybe someone gets to be a doctor, not necessarily to help people, but because, you know, through some sort of secondary opinion where, you know, their parents told them that, oh, if you become a doctor, you're going to be rich and successful and all that. And then they finally get to that point where they are the doctor. And then they're like, oh shit, I didn't want to do this the entire time. And I was just listening to other people and letting other people affect the way that I do things, you know? So I think whether you're a doctor or you're a lawyer or you're an artist, to really be happy and unjaded by the process, you have to understand why you're doing that specific thing to some degree.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I mean, totally agree with that. Yeah. Like so it is like this kind of like ongoing,
struggle.
Of a struggle, yeah, because I don't really like the whole like that whole part of our culture that says like exert effort. Like, in other words, like, because it's too kind of simplistic, right? There are people all around the world that are like laboring, exerting all their physical energy to make essentially nothing, right? I think it's a seductive idea. Like, I just need to try hard, work really hard, and I'll be better. Because look how hard I work. And it's an idea that you can sell to other people really well. You know, follow my course in 99 easy ways to work harder and be successful or whatever. Versus like doing the right thing, the appropriate thing, the appropriate amount of like using.
What is the right thing?
The thing that feels good, right? In other words, like if you have to like hammer a nail, you have to put a nail in a wall thing, right? And you don't have a hammer and you use your thumb, it's gonna hurt, it's gonna be painful. I can exert all the effort I want, right? But it's not gonna it's gonna suck, right? And there's gonna be physical pain, there's gonna be everything about it saying like, this is not cool, this is not good, right? We need to figure something else out. So use like a shoe or whatever. Eventually I guess you get to a hammer or whatever, but the hammer is relative to your thumb is effortless, right? There's less effort involved, and there's like this satisfaction in its effortlessness. And it's like when you use a lever or you use like something like a crowbar, there's just like the fact that you're exerting a lot of force with minimal effort, which is actually more, you know, what I'm looking for are those kinds of situations where I'm, you know, where I find myself, you know, either like literally in terms of the practice, like with painting or something like that. Mm-hmm. Where I feel like I'm like I'm trying too hard, or it's like a misplaced amount of energy, or there's a better way, or whatever. And literally in painting, for example, it could be just using a larger brush, and then you go like, okay, I got this area filled in. And sometimes it's more, you know, abstract. It's like an idea. It's just an idea that sits well, right? Because like, you know, there's always these problems in your mind. That are just kind of like nipping at you, right? Like little things that are just like kind of like aggravating you, and I think that it is possible to at least address it, you know. So that's where, I mean, I kind of like make fun of like mindfulness stuff, but the good thing about it is that you do become more aware of like what your actual thoughts are, good or bad, right?
Yeah.
So there's a little less of that kind of like reaction. You give yourself a little bit of time to think like, oh, this is what I'm thinking, whether it's good or bad. So just being able to identify those things, and over time realizing like, what do you want to do about it? You know what I mean? Like for me, like whenever I come to LA, for example, like on one hand, I want to be part of like around people and be a part of culture and things like that. But then there's this other part of me that says, that literally feels kind of like overwhelmed, or just like visually just all this stuff going on, freeways, things like that. And so there's that aggravation, so there's this problem in my mind that I'm just over time slowly chipping away at. Like, well, maybe it means I just need to live on the outskirts, or maybe it means I want to travel more, or maybe it means I should just stay put in Oxford, I don't know. Or maybe there's other things that are more important, because to live here would mean other kind of sacrifices, things like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's just like a life example, but that happens in like all the time, just, you know, within like your practice, you know, within photography, like within photography itself, you know. Like within photography, there's like the whole school of people that get into like, you know, pixel peeping, like technical stuff, you know, like resolution and things like that, because that gives them a clear path to kind of alleviates a certain amount of like anxiety in terms of what to do. So I would say like if someone's just like almost like has a like a, almost like a childlike fascination with a certain aspect and they follow that, I would say that, I don't want to say it's better or worse, but I would feel like it's like less problematic versus say ultra high resolution photography became like the scene, right? Like so impressionism or abstraction. So all of a sudden everyone's like, yeah, your pixels are so blurry. You know what I mean? Then a new photographer might like see that and feel like really like irritated and annoyed or even kind of like resentful. Like, why is everyone talking about this? Doesn't really matter. And so,
yeah, I see.
And they would have to go kind of against the grain.
For sure.
Right? So there's so many of these things that just all like, you know, are like interwoven. Mm-hmm. And how do you know? Like, how does a person know? Like, you know, you can't. There's some things that you can be interested in that's like there are literally no books about it or nothing you can Google and like no like top 10 list or whatever.
Yeah.
Right. So who do you listen to? What do you refer to? And I think it's really just like, you know, whatever that thing is, you just like, how do you feel about it? Does it interest you? Do you feel motivated by it? Does it, you know what I mean? It's like the healthy person that runs. So it's like this healthy part of your brain that just wants to run with the idea or whatever, you know? But, you know, so there's that aspect and then there's that social aspect, right? So I think everyone is kind of pushed and pulled by those two things because, you know, someone that, you know, that same person fascinated with pixels, he can be like, he can have other parts of his self that he wants to like buttress and validate and then he'll create like a manifesto and essays and like TED Talks about why pixels matter and things like that.
Yeah.
Right.
Well,
so he takes this very innocent and like pure thing and it can be this kind of like weird like social kind of almost like monster or whatever. And to me I say it's monster, but to another person it's their livelihood or it's their scene. Like some people are really into certain types of art and that's like what they identify with. You know, music is like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there anything else that you wanna talk about? Or is there anything where can people find you on social media?
STVKMCO.
Yeah.
Or just Steve Kim. Usually something pops up.
You have a show going on right now too in Texas.
Yes. It's a part of a group show. I have 8 pieces in there.
Okay.
And a couple pieces in that's at Fort Worth Gallery in Fort Worth, Texas. And a couple pieces in Denver at Helicon Gallery.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll have to do something for the Supersonic Invitational in New York at Spoke Art. Other than that, and the Cambodia thing is not much.
Cool, man.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for coming and thanks for talking on RS Decoded, man.
All right. Thank you. All right.